this stuff is becoming bigger and we need to be faster, and functional programming is kind of getting niche in our requirements and just getting a lot stronger. So in this one, in this session, we're going to talk first of all, really excited to talk about real-time programming in Haskell. I never thought I'd say those words, but here we are today. And then afterwards, we've got how many people here play PlayStation? PlayStation, Xbox? Oh yeah, we've got a few gamers. We have a really cool talk coming up on programming games. And a few talks on big data. So this is a whole trend towards doing a huge amount of computation on gigabytes and terabytes of data. So this is really diverse. This is really a diverse session on functional programming and the rest of the world. So let's first of all welcome Gregory Wright from Alcatel-Lucent, and he's going to tell us about Haskell in real time.
Hi, my name is Greg Wright. I'm from Alcatel-Lucent Bell Labs. Talking to Dr. Butler, and especially asking me if we're dead yet. No, we're not. We're hanging in there at the news. And I'm also a member of this thing called Green Map Consortium, the wide scale kind of systems working group, which I will tell you about in just a moment. For most of today, you've heard about just complicated systems and how we can use functional programming to take these complicated systems, manage the complexity, get control of the way things interact, and build these marvelous, highly engineered, large systems which can do wonderful things. This is not going to be a talk like that. This is going to be a talk about parachuting in, taking a problem, whacking it on the side of the head, leaving it stuck on the ground, and then going off and having a beer. In this talk, our theory of functional programming shows itself as not merely stable provided a value, but as fleet as a foot and not a little brace under pressure. We're going to talk about how we can use natural computing, real-time programming, not really hard real-time programming, but at least soft real-time programming. And why do we need to do this? We're working on a project called large-scale antenna systems. And what this is all about is trying to reduce the amount of energy used in wireless networks. Communication networks use about 2%, a little less maybe, of the entire electricity consumed on the planet. And it's going up rapidly. If we continue at the current rate, we end up using the internet, ends up using up all the power in 25 years. Mobile communication is actually most of that. It's about 70%. Powering wireless base stations everywhere is quite costly in terms of energy. So what we have been working on is a way to try and reduce that. And the way we do that is we use lots of antennas instead of just a few. If you see a GSM base station in Europe, they usually have three antennas per user, three antennas per service provider per base station. If you go to the US, you usually see four antennas per sector, 12 antennas per service provider at a base station. So we use a little fancier signal processing to allow us to get by with fewer base stations. Our concept is to use hundreds or perhaps even thousands of antennas to focus very narrow beams on the users. So we can give them the same kind of service they get now, but not spend as much energy. I mean, currently today, the antennas up on top of that tower, standing in that field, what are they doing? They're mostly eating earthworms and not actually sending power that can be usefully used for communication. So we're going to build an array of antennas. We are going to use it to generate beams. We can put those beams simultaneously on many users. We can track the users as they move. And the point of this is reduce energy. Well, what we use is improved energy efficiency. So we use fewer tools per bit. And maybe if we have lots of these narrow beams and they don't interfere with each other much, we can gain in terms of communication efficiency as well. So we'll get 4 bits per second per hertz of bandwidth. And it has some other good things too. There are ways that we can combine all the complexity to the base station. So we don't have to mess with your phone. You don't need to have a new generation of phones. We can just build this into the network. And the average energy savings are wonderful. They're independent of propagation conditions. So it doesn't require a lot of additional engineering to the network. And for any telecom nerds out here, it doesn't require cooperation between base stations. So this would be a really good thing if we could reduce the amount of energy required in the base station. Who would be doing such a thing? There is an industry organization called Green Touch. Alcatel-Lucent is one of the founding members where I work. But essentially what they are trying to do is to provide a technology roadmap to reduce the amount of energy required by the network, but essentially improve the energy efficiency of the network for very highly self-interested reasons. Clearly, if in 25 years the internet is going to use all the electricity on the earth, something's going to change. It's probably going to be adverse for our companies. So we'd like to improve the energy efficiency of the hardware that's out there so the service providers, our customers, can continue to make money. And this particular demonstration was done by Alcatel-Lucent and our partners in Green Touch, Freescale Semiconductor, Huawei, IMEC, Orange, actually a service provider, and Samsung, the Samsung Advanced Institute of Technology, their internal research labs. So, what do we have to do? We had to make a demonstration that this technology could actually work. We want to show that it would scale as we added more and more antennas. And we would also, we didn't really need to do it as a technical demonstration, but to, in fact, show people that this will really work. We want it to run in real time, at least within the confines of the demonstration room, so they could see that it worked and have some confidence that this technology would do what we said it would do. So it was first shown at a press event in London on the 1st of February of this year. So what is it? What do we build? Well, there's a bunch of antennas. All the antennas are identical. They have radio stuff. There's radio stuff here. And essentially, that just takes the signals that the antennas collect and gets it into a format which we can process from the computer. 16-bit ints. Word 16. And inside the computer, we basically have this software radio, which takes this all the received signals from the 16 channels, well, it's actually kind of 32, because we're doing such a different complex, using complex signals, figures out how to point a beam at this user over here, and also figures out how much data we can send over this radio wave. Right. If people have questions, just raise your hand and shout. So we're going to figure out how to point the beam at the handset, and we're going to figure out how much data we can send over that particular wave. Then what we're going to do is we're going to adjust the amount of power that we're using in the handset to go to a target data rate. So this is what happens in your phone and with the base station. You have your phone, the base station figures out, now you're not with a narrow beam, but just receives a signal from your handset, and says, the signal's this strong, to send your call, it doesn't need to be that strong, you can turn down your power. So it sends a message back to the phone, say, turn down your power. It doesn't happen, it happens to your phone, power goes down. So one of the key things is, in the phone network, we're always controlling the power to maintain a constant quality of service. But we don't want to send really more power than we need to get that quality of service. So that's what we actually demonstrate. Now, because it's just a prototype, we didn't send back over the air the commands to burn down the power. We used a wire. But what we showed is that this whole thing would work. We could focus a beam on the simulated handset, we could compute the data rate in real time, and then we could adjust the power coming out of the handset so that the data rate was at the target value. And what we actually would show to the user was how much power was coming out of the handset. demonstration was that as we turned on more and more antennas, you know, the algorithm is completely adaptive. It just needs to know that this antenna is on, that antenna is on. Figures out as best it can how to point a beam at the thing, adjust the power to get the target data rate, and we show on the screen this little gauge which moves back and forth, and as the power drops, the gauge drops. And so you can see that really in sort of a very visual way, that the amount of power needed is simply inversely proportional to the number of antennas that we're using. This talk is called 14 days of Haskell. We started on this project on October 4th for various organizational reasons. So we think we have 4 months, but in fact, at this point, we didn't actually have any hardware to do, so we had to build all this stuff. We're not going to buy all this stuff. So we didn't get to program until kind of close to the end. There were some milestones in here. We were trying to buy all the parts for this. And in the middle of November, we swiped the credit card so many times that it melted. We had to find, you know, some vice president's credit card to use. And by the way, we weren't going to do it in Haskell originally. We have another vendor who's going to deliver this whiz-banging radio module that was going to plug into our FPGA cards, and they say it may ship sometime in the next 2 quarters from now. But they were still promising it back here. So back in December, we're on plan B. We're looking for the old hardware. We knew we had some old hardware for that. And we're stuffing it into a rack and figuring out how to write a software radio to try that. By the beginning of December, we're starting to get all the hardware. The computers, thankfully, have shown up at this point. We have our data acquisition cards. We pulled the backup radio hardware off the shelf and got it all done. Unfortunately, that was one of the least troublesome things. And so by around Christmas time, we're ready to start. Everything's bolted into the rack, and we're ready to start writing software to make it run. If you were in New Jersey around Christmas time, 2010, you remember that, 1976, we got a meter of snow, which slowed things down a bit. But fortunately, we had gone up to the office to grab all the computers, and now we have essentially from the day after Christmas till around January 10th to put together the software radio. So what's in it? This is kind of a diagram of what the major modules are. In fact, this and this run actually as independent processes on different processor cores. We put this on a standard, x86-64 8-core machine that we spent $1,800 for. It wasn't very fancy. But we used standard National Instruments analog digital converter cards. We used the Linux the control and measurement device interface, because we are encouraged to work in open source here. And we just simply take things, format them in the simplest possible Haskell manner as arrays of lazy lists of arrays. They're not even unboxed arrays. It's really, what we did is get off the shelf and stick together as fast as we could. We use SVM to talk between these two processes, which may be a bit overkill, but I'll try to make a case for that in just a moment. And most of the rest of the control flow is just to send packets out of UDP ports to control various things. One of the controls is actually the power level in the handset by driving a signal generator. There's some things that you can show the command and power and the data rates, and we can drive displays. There is also a way to turn on and off all the channels, which just listens on UDP port 3001. This one of the things which we could do with this part of the demonstration is control it remotely from a tablet computer so that people could play with it. For this project, I bought 0.02% of the entire world production of one of the less popular tablets. But, you know, every once in my past, but we couldn't use that for other reasons. But it's a very, very simple architecture. It is all basically all pull. The data flows from one side to the other. It is, you know, every array that gets consumed, essentially the natural data flow architecture of the problem helps to prevent the usual things which you would fear doing something like this in, you know, lazy language like Haskell, space links. So, you know, again, did it fast, didn't worry about efficiency. The main concern was that it would not crash when we ran it, and that it also would run smoothly. There'd be no glitches, it wouldn't stop for a while. We wouldn't see strange effects which would, you know, lead people to question whether we were actually showing what we said we did. So again, you know, what we is essentially off-the-shelf things, and we didn't shy away from using big hammers and small knots. Our basic data representation coming out of the converter module, laceless array. We use the DSP library from Haggage. Be careful if you go there, it has surprises in it. But it has a good wrapper around the FFT routines, okay? Even though they spend a lot of time marshaling, those are really rock solid, but watch out for other stuff. We're going to use software transactional. Now we're going to connect these bits because we just want them to run on different cores and have it take care of itself. And, you know, we threw in all these little simple network servers to blast off packets so we could show things. I actually ran on other computers that were hooked up by Ethernet. So, you know, we're trying to write this as a Haskell program. We're not trying to do this as a C program in Haskell because, well, you know, it's got to be like C if we're going to make it efficient. And it seems to be working. One of the other things we didn't do, we didn't do anything. No voodoo. Okay? We're not going to put, well, I'm embarrassed to say, but last night when I checked this statement, I found a bad pattern in the bed. I think I copied it out of someone else's code. It's just used to compute the mean value of an array. But that was it. You know, so we're not doing any of this strictness annotation or anything fancy to enforce good memory behavior. And the whole thing does have exemplary heap performance when I'm climbing up in a lateral profile. So what we did, how do we actually make it work? Well, let's just go through the process. The first day is, you know, we're snowed in, can't get into the office. So I build a data simulator, which makes noise and signals that we expect, and has exactly the same interface as I get out of my ADC driver module, which is written in the written Haskell with a C shape. So it's exactly the same format. We can start testing the actual computational modules. And in the end, we should be able to just rip the fake data generator out and plug it into a real data source. So then the next day, we actually implemented the data rate. So this is the wireless data rate calculation. And it's based upon, you know, solid communication theory. It, in fact, has some refinements, which are the result of our research into just how to make this algorithm scale. It turns out that many of the naive implementations of this won't work for hundreds or thousands of antennas. And we're really trying to show that this thing, as you increase the number of antennas, those antenna beams get narrower and the amount of power you need to use continues to drop. So it does all that fancy stuff, figuring out how to compute the beams and what the data rate is going to do. And after we did that, we took the great calculation, we stuck it together with the data acquisition system because they finally cleared the roads and we get into the office and we're running Ubuntu and my blasted stuff with Linux on SUSE. So the data file system is different now, but we got the data acquisition stuff to run once we figured out permission stuff. And least the data's going through halfway. It's not controlling the power yet, but it's New Year's Eve. We're going to take off New Year's Day. Now, one of the other things which this demo has is in order to show the people which of the antennas are actually turned on, we have above each module a green light. It's going to pull up green and the efficiency thing. And my, at this point, my Haskell code is unable to turn the green lights on and off. And we are getting somewhat concerned about this, but it turns out to be a wiring error in the rack. And so the other important lesson there, you know, as a functional programmer, it's not always about you. So here's an obligatory code example. The nice thing about this is, essentially, I was able to sit down with the technical memo describing, you know, our scalable algorithm and more or less type it in. That's partly because of the closeness of the Haskell syntax to math. Now, it's not exclusively a property of Haskell. You know, I could have done it in MATLAB, which also has a nice notation for signal processing, but, you know, it's crap as a programming language. So what we're getting here is we're getting this sort of mathematical elegance for being able to use Haskell with the advantage of the simple control structure, both the simple to use for this kind of application control structure, where we actually have lazy lists, we don't have to worry about how we synchronize things, we just stuff the boxes together. On the 10th day of work, we did the servo loop. The servo loop is in fact implemented in Haskell too. It does a fairly simple proportional integral loop. On the 11th day, we turned it all on and ran. And it actually worked. So we actually would be able to adjust the power level to maintain a constant data rate, which we told it what we wanted the data rate to be, and it would adjust. And if we move the thing around, it would readjust the beam and find out where the handset was. The things you know, the reason we're going to test it all day, I mean, essentially a Bernoulli test, is we're still a little scared that there might be a memory leak somewhere. But it worked. So ran overnight. There's no indication of it behaving badly. We packed it, sent it off to our test anechoic chamber, and we had our showtime with our PR people who videoed us doing the demo before we sent it off to London. So did it succeed?
So he said we for all that.
We mean you. I wrote all the code. But in terms of getting the antenna built, getting the data acquisition running, I had the help of Wong Tran in our department and Jonathan Lane. So they were, you know, they were there too, getting the whole thing put together. Particularly Wong Tran figured out the stuff about the green blinking lights. I was sure it was software, you know. Did it succeed? It is well known that never fail. However, they sometimes may return an empty list of successes. Oh, there are old timers here. So, what came out of all this? In a couple of weeks, we took lines of C. Fairly stereotypical data acquisition driver and stuff. And 600 lines non-comment, not counting the library stuff that we use. Of this Haskell, but you know, we're willing to go out in front of reporters and not be embarrassed with it. This one looks like in the anechoic chamber. Each one of these vertical four-patch things is an antenna. It's one of the 16 antenna modules. This is the rack with all the equipment, the particularly unprepossessing bits are stuffed around the back so you can't see it. And here's our GUI, which is actually written in Java, but we're sending off UDP packets to this. And it's showing, look, the power that's used is way down here. And if you turn on one of these, it goes all the way back up. So in fact, we're able to show that with the 16 elements, as we turn on each additional element, we actually get the full expected gain, so this process continues to scale. And within the accuracy of our measurement, it's perfect. You can actually see me gesticulating in a similar way, actually in that room, in a YouTube video. I hope actually to, we have the thing in that anechoic chamber right now, and I hope to run it remotely for you, but I was not able to because that's in a special super secure area of the network that we can't even get into from other bits of our company. So now you can write a software radio in Haskell. Let's try. Well, you know, the answer is not quite. We solved a big piece of the problem. This is channel estimation, where, well, it's a fancy word for channel estimation, you actually form a mean. And that's about half the work in implementing a real radio. We could have added onto this a low data rate, few kilobit data acquisition, an actual data traffic channel. And we had the processing power to do it, no problem, but it didn't seem to add anything to the particular demonstration, and we didn't have enough time to do it. There's lots of, in a real protocol, there's many problems of implementing, not the software radio in Haskell, the software radio in general. The more recent protocols, UMTS, called 3G, most places, LTE, 4G, has extremely tight latency requirements, mostly to support users going on high-speed trains. They have large doppler shifts, and very rapidly varying signals, and in many cases the latency requirements prevent us from actually putting any processing more than about 1 or 2 kilometers from the radio tower itself, just limited by light travel time. So it's sometimes hard to remote. Actually, as an active topic of research, I'm looking at what we need to do to fix that, to do latency tolerant protocols. So, this was a pretty big win for us. But what do we really want from functional programming? Darren said this morning, we have this secret method, and it's wonderful, and no one seems to care about it. But are we really after this big payoff? We want to do fast delivery. This was a fast delivery project, it worked. Or we want to do really high performance, so you have things are scaled up, billions of transactions per second. And the kind of people who come here want that. However, almost everyone else I know in the biz wants a lower risk of a fail to meet the specs or programmatic disaster. Programmatic disaster is when you just couldn't get it to work. And this is true in many fields of endeavor. I used to think that on Wall Street, people were out there for the big score. But then I had friends who moved to hedge funds saying, all we care about is doing 2% better than the S&P 500 over a long period of time with no risk of finding out. And then programming projects are often the same way. We're not so much interested in the big win, but what we want is a lot of security from like crashing and burning. We like the former, but most of the world could be the latter. So,
why is it?
In particular, we didn't ask for it, but one thing that we did very deliberately and carefully was to make sure that the system always worked. We developed the system essentially along the data flow. So we started with the data source, the data acquisition, we did the rate calculation, we did the servo. We always made sure that everything earlier in the signal path always worked before we moved further on. And if we ever broke it, earlier parts, we immediately went back and fixed them. And this was very important. First of all, it was most important because it prevented panic when the whole thing seemed not to work. At least you knew that it worked up to a point, you could always go back there. at CUFP last year, which made a real impression on me. And that was a project which was successful and did well, but the person who reported this manager was unhappy with it. Because they were messing with it for a long time, and they were trying out something with typed programming. They hadn't done much about that before. And the project, management saw, doesn't work. Oh, all of a sudden it works! And we wanted to, for our own sake, our own sanity, to avoid that situation. And I think that that's probably, if we could only have people come here who are on failed functional programming projects to tell us whether or not that happened, it would be an excellent education. We worked with the Haskell idioms instead of against them. And that was, we had a data flow problem. We've always said that data flow problems are great for functional programming, and with a bit of experience, it's true. So, are we smart or just lucky? Well, your fortune favors the prepared. And a little bit of experience in functional programming, you can do some fairly substantial projects. But even some ones that people don't think.
Thank you, speaker.